is Sensitive Souls and Biosemiotic Agency as Emergence by Yogi Hale Hendlin in Biosemiotics. Yeah, semaphore is like a signaling system, and semiotics is the study of signs. So I assume the sem base has to do with signs and signals. Okay, so here we go. And as always, feel free to make comments, ask questions. My first time reading it, too. So background, biosemioticians seldom discuss consciousness. Whether that was a conscious decision or not, semiosis rather than consciousness has been our domain of research. Yeah, so there's the study of signs, like the semiosis. So, like, how do you actually relate signs to each other? We replace some of the problems associated with cuts in the differentia specifica of consciousness with other capacities, namely the capacity to interpret according to species-specific constraints. Agency has been variously defined in biosemiotics, but instead of being an on or off switch, it is viewed as having stages or gradations. Hofstetter has hypothesized that, like agency, consciousness is a more or less property. So you get more or less of consciousness, I guess. More radically, consciousness may have certain zero-sum properties unapparent through behavioral observation alone. That is, an ethos of consciousness may be hopelessly constrained by the consciousness of the observer or willingness of the consciousness of the observer to stretch, bend, reduce, or change their own attachment to what consciousness is and does. Okay, from Semyon, a marker, sign, or token. Interesting. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense, though. The field of biosemiotics has largely bracketed the question of consciousness for a variety of definitional and pragmatic reasons, as scholars increasingly aware of the extended, embedded, embodied, inactive, ecological, and affective modes of cognition, the biological and ecological basis for experiencing has unfurled a variety of interpretations of consciousness and its potential instantiations. Yeah, like, these are all buzzwords in philosophy and, like, philosophy of mind, so I didn't know it was the five EAs. That's kind of funny. Five EAs. So extended, embedded, embodied, inactive, ecological, and affective. So these must be the standard sort of different ways we talk about it. So, author says, I hesitate to use the word levels of consciousness because of our Linnaean prejudices that a given level which confers certain advantages ipso facto also denotes superiority rather than trade-offs. Yeah, you don't want to be saying, like, some people don't have the highest level of consciousness, because then you're going to get into, like, this, like, higher and lower races or whatever. 5EA sounds like a 90s boy band. Yeah, it could even be a today's boy band, like a, you know, a K-pop group would be 5EA. That would work as K-pop. Dividing consciousness into discrete and hierarchical levels tends to reinforce human exceptionalist notions of competition rather than scientifically asking what organisms do and how they do it. This is perhaps the pragmatist strain in biosemiotics that focuses on agency and action. Superior capacities in one area, say ideation or hypostatic abstraction, to use Sternfeld's distinguishing factor, may also entail reductions in access to other just as important aspects of experiencing. With the art and science that comes with human cognition also comes the ability to be violent and cruel, attributes unique, as far as we know, to species on this planet. Yeah, so I guess we got a little bit of a graph here. So we've got lots of consciousness that'd be normal human adults, then it goes down to brain damaged and senile humans. I guess kids also might fall into that. Primates, cetaceans, cephalopods. So I guess if you have, like, what are those, octopus or whatever, like the cephalopods, because they're pretty smart things. Dogs, chickens, goldfish, bees, trees, fungi, microbes, viruses, molecules, and, you know, maybe they have just itsy little bits of consciousness. I know, I'm sure the cats would come, like, up here with the doggies. Like, I'm sure it'd be somewhere in here, but this is obviously a dog person. So, yeah. Where would MAGA go in that diagram? I wouldn't put them here because that would be insulting to, like, the bees who can actually do math. I don't know if MAGA can, so, you know, bees can do math, and trees are, like, actually useful, so I'd feel bad about placing them anywhere. I mean, I guess you could say, I don't know. Brain damaged people don't need that shit. So I wouldn't put them up there either. But I suppose this is where cats would go. So, cat. Outside of it, into the bin, yeah. I mean, they're somewhere here in the no consciousness area. So, although that's unfair. So there's the levels of consciousness, but again, like, you can see how problematic this would become, because you'd start, once you start ranking, like, humans up, like, up here, then you could say, well, some people are here, some people are just above brain damaged, some people are higher, like, they're just smarter, and then you get, like, the typical bullshit where you start attaching race to this and other things, and that gets kind of ugly. But, yeah. So, like, so, what are you gonna do? Alright. But you can see, that's why the biosemiotic, so we're saying, well, we're going to look at how people actually do stuff. We're not going to just make a whole group of this sort of consciousness thing. Okay, so author is pleased biosemiotics can produce can productively interface with Jablonka and Ginsberg's unlimited associative learning theory of consciousness. The authors focus on percepts and feelings in their target article, similarly to their flagship 2019 book, The Evolution of the Sensitive Soul, Learning and the Origins of Consciousness, engaging in an evolutionary reframing of Aristotle's schema of action and agency. Here I'll focus on pluralizing our spectra of consciousness and discuss the differences between the paradigm of consciousness expressed by Jablonka and Ginsberg and that of semiosis. I'd put philosophers just below normal adult humans. Yeah, I mean, there's a question, like, there's a lot of, like, philosophers are weird people. So, I mean, normal people might be here, and then philosophers ask all these weird questions. We might go in sort of, like, this, like, like, this lower tier somewhere over here. Maybe. But, like, yeah. Who knows? But, like, that's the thing. Once you start ranking people, it's like, you're gonna be like, well, you do it by race, you do it by country, you'd be like, oh, those people suck. Group of people. It's like, yeah, it's not really worth it. So. And then you get, like, how smart really are goldfish versus bees? Like, does this actually even make sense? Do we even understand what this ranking means here when you're ranking goldfish versus bees? It's like, we don't, like, bees can do math as far as we can tell now. Can goldfish do math? I don't know. But you can also go look up the old Mythbusters episode where you'd be like, well, you have a mind of a goldfish is an insult. And basically, Jamie used to run a pet store. He knew you could train goldfish. You can train goldfish to do stuff. And that's what he did. He had a goldfish, like, obstacle course the goldfish would go through. Yeah. Bees do, yeah, they dance. Bees are dancers. It's great. So, and they communicate things. They have interpretive dance. So, this is the thing. So, that's why things like this are hard. Maybe in, like, the very grand scheme of things, but once you start getting into the details, it's extremely difficult. Like, dogs can recognize human facial, human faces and, like, our emotions. I don't know if, you know, octopi can recognize human emotions. They can definitely do other stuff though, like dogs dream and stuff. So it's like, who's to say what's better or more important? Is understanding human emotion more important, what a dog does, or is something, you know, that octopus does more important? I don't know. Yeah. But see, yeah, again, this person's criticizing. We've got, and we were talking about this at the beginning of the thing with that Heraclitus quote, wisdom is set apart. And so this is clearly a spectrum right here. You've got a spectrum of consciousness, and wisdom is supposed to be set apart according to Heraclitus. So maybe that's not even the right way to do it, although that would be very exceptionalist. And this author has already criticized that. Okay, consciousness, a single spectrum or various strands. Jablonka and Ginsberg lean heavily on Aristotle in their target article as well as their book to develop their theory of consciousness. Yet the constitutive action of organisms is not something that only higher animals possess. Yes, the way action is constituted materially and immaterially is different from different classifications of organism, absolutely. But the underlying mechanisms can be vastly divergent, say insects and plants, while still producing similar minded outcomes. This is the importance in biology of multiple evolutionary pathways solving the question of life rather than a single approach. Ecological fitting solves distinct ecological niche puzzles. The plurality of consciousness, incomparable through those consciousness incomparable though those consciousness may be, do not preclude the element of choice, which is decisive for semiosis. Yeah, so it's like there may be more than one way to be conscious, and the way we do it may not be the same way something else does it, and that would be hard for us to recognize because we only understand our own. And this is always a problem with recognizing aliens. Like, how would we actually know when we found an alien or like an alien intelligence? Something we were also discussing with about on Ivan Neo's stream before this. It's can we act like Ivan was holding that? Basically, we're sort of at the end of we're at the end of the information sort of like ramp. Once from now on, we will always be able to understand stuff, even if it's like more complicated. It's just a question of us learning the right background material. It isn't like there's like some hard break where we'd actually have to like change the way we think about things to then understand what's going on. I'm not so sure about this, to tell you the truth. Like, it's been like in thousands of years, we've changed the way we thought about the world. I'm not confident that like this was the last change. People always think they're at the end of humanity. And it's, I have no idea what that is, Vipers. Darmok and Galad at Tanagra. Shaka when the walls fell. I have no idea. Okay. But like, yeah, everyone always thinks, and this happens in physics where, and he knows this, he brought up the example. It's like everyone always thinks they're at the end of physics. And then, you know, then something big happens and like, oh my God, quantum physics. They thought at the end of the 19th century that basically a few little things had to be cleaned up and then we'll have basically physics worked out. Clearly not what happened. Okay, so semiosis is work in action. For Aristotle, the potentiality dunamis for work or activity, energeia, according to the species-specific abilities, eidos, and purpose, ergon, of the organism is defined by the species of organism. Yeah, so whatever kind of thing you are, you have stuff you can do and like in the way you do it. Semiosis is the constitutive activity of how living beings organize and produce themselves as what they are, similar to Maturana and Varela's autopoiesis, but with the emphasis on meaning, making, and interaction rather than self-making. Yeah, so semiosis is the, you know, the generation of signs, I guess. The holomorphism of an organism that's formed matter. The formed matter, it's Aristotle's theory of ontology. Of an organism brings together its material and immaterial action, thus yoking together action and consciousness, however constrained or species-specific. The presence of agency and action, even at the most basic level of life, is encapsulated in Kaufman's example of a bacterium swimming up a glucose gradient, or in the quorum sensing an apoptosis of slime molds. Okay, I don't even, sensing and apoptosis, I don't know what the slime molds are doing. But yeah, it's like things understand like their environment a little bit, and like they can do stuff. So again, the bacterium swimming up towards the sugar source, it's like this is what it does. It has a form, it has a body, and that's what it does. Viper says it's from the Next Generation episode called Darmok, where they meet a new species, but the universal translator was spitting out gibberish. As it turns out, the species language was based entirely on metaphor unique to their culture, and Picard had to learn it the hard way. Yes. So this is the thing. Maybe there's a way that there actually is something that is beyond just like the what our technology can give us. If it's so different, is it like the universal translator doesn't work? And in this case, I guess it's species specific, or what's the word? Not anachronistic. Whatever it is, it's just very, very unique to a person or a group. So it's like, yeah, you have to understand what's going on first, and that takes work. So sometimes you have to learn more before anything makes sense. And the problem is, we're assuming that we already have all the base concepts down. I'm not sure we have the base concepts down. It's like, do we understand consciousness? No. Do we understand something of consciousness? Yes. But maybe in the future, our understanding of consciousness will evolve so much that the things we think we're talking about now really won't make sense according to like future scientists. And so it'll be like, all right, like the people who were doing alchemy back in the day would not understand like modern chemistry. Not their fault. That was just the best that they had at the time. So it's like, I'm not so sure we're any better off than the people in the past compared to people in our like a distant future. I really like I don't see why we're special. So you'd need a very, very, very good reason to say, look, we're really special at this point, to convince me that we are special and that we actually have got something that will last indefinitely into the future. And the indefinite future is just so big that, like, I wouldn't make that claim. I don't know how you'd even make that claim. I mean, people want to be like, we have knowledge now, but like, eh. Adam Fighter says, we'll always generate new concepts, returning to the fertilization tech. Its inception created an ever more thought of more malicious. Exactly. Now, the position is, it's like, well, we can sort of talk about that anyway. It's still like on our continuum of what we can talk about. But I mean, give like thousands of years of technology, I'm not actually convinced that we will actually make sense. Anne says, but my mom told me I am special. Oh, yes, you are. You're very special, Anne. Very, very special. But, So, like I said, yeah, that's one of the things I actually like about Aeon Flux. Speaking of Aeon Flux, the thing, it's Aeon Flux basically is very far in the future, and their tech is not like our tech. Their tech is weird. Like, we don't really understand like what's going on in Aeon Flux technology sometimes. It just doesn't make sense according to like our way of technology now. That's one of the things I like about it. So it's not really a near future, it's a much farther future, and it doesn't have to make sense. It's more like a magic, but they don't have magic in the Aeon Flux universe. They just have like advanced technology. The people in Special Force are special too. Yeah, that's a different kind of special though. I mean, so. Okay. Where were we? Yeah, we were talking about, you know, organisms have like a structure and form, and that allows them to do different things. The Aeon Flux, what Aeon Flux universe? Not a non-flux. Aeon Flux. It was this old comic on MTV. It was very well liked, and they made a movie out of it, a live action one, but like the movie wasn't great. I liked the movie, but it wasn't. The themes in the TV show were very different. Yeah. So yeah, it was it was Western. I don't think the guy's name was Peter Chung, but like I think he was like from the United States or whatever. Yeah. So it was one of these liquid television things that they had on MTV. Not really a Japanese based stuff. Yeah, actually, I literally have an emote. This is from the opening sequence. It's the Aeon Flux Eye. So, I don't know how to say it, Vipers. I just say Aeon Flux. Could be Eon. Like, I think they definitely call her like Eon. But like, it's AE, so it's like, who knows? Yeah. It was well liked. It's not hard to find. It's Eon. All right. Well, I'm going to keep saying it the way the fuck I want to because I don't give a shit. Sorry. Yeah. Although remarkable in their evolutionary story of the emergence of consciousness with UAL as the crux, the authors do not incorporate much of the good work in philosophy of mind, suggesting that different types of consciousness or intentionality, sensus phenomenology, not analytic philosophy, can occur according to, say, varieties of neutral monism. Consciousness may well be far more diverse than we give credit. Pluralistic theories of modes of consciousness resist higher/lower designations. Comparative consciousness studies instead outline the Venn diagram of differential consciousnesses. Plant and animal modes of consciousness, for example, while employing vastly different anatomical systems, nonetheless have some considerable overlap in terms of their abilities to sense and make sense of their environment and respond according to their species-specific constraints. Viper says, you can do that, but when I want to pronounce your name with an I in place of an O, everyone gets upset. Well, I mean, that's your choice. I mean, no one can stop you for, you know, your pronunciations, but you gotta live with the consequences, though, too. Yeah, exactly. Nogrio. See, a lot of people say Nogrio. Like, that's true. Nogrio. Instead of Nogur. Yeah, let's go with that. And my name used to get auto-modded. Like, you couldn't at me in chat for a long time without having to get like the mods to let it go. Just the NGR base screwed it up. Okay, such organismic camaraderie and continuity of consciousness. Again, what's up, Aris? We could let's give Aris a shout out. Shout out, our buddy Aris. Yeah, and Vipers, when are you going getting back to streaming? My buddy Aris, he streams ancient philosophy and like ethics and has these great AMA streams where you can ask him anything. And people do ask him anything, and it gets kind of a little off the wall at times, but it's a lot of fun, and you can, you know, discuss all sorts of life experiences, and he's good with that. Real good with that shit. So yeah, discuss philosophy and classic stuff, and does ancient philosophy and ethics, and doing some work on the Cynics. It's good times. So if you don't know him, give him a follow and just check out the streams. Yes, and he wears a luchador mask. So, once in a while. Okay, such, yeah, organismic camaraderie and continuity of consciousness is disputed by Ginsburg and Jablanka and Ginsburg 22, as they write, the hiatus between vivacious living organisms and non-vivacious machines is as large as that between conscious and non-conscious living organisms. You meant to stream several times this week, but each time you couldn't be arsed. Yeah, you know, that's the thing. You need it. Content ain't easy. Content ain't easy at all. This chunking up of agency into vivacity and consciousness seems to kick the can of agency down the road by continuing with discrete cuts, which then further beg questions of exceptions. Yeah, so it's the thing. It's like, you're not going to explain consciousness. You're going to keep talking about one or two little things. Then how do you know that you're actually getting anywhere? So, invertebrate swarms may have in aggregate more intelligence than some mammals. It is also likely that certain plants may have some more semiotic agency and complexity than some animals, but that we are biased in our designation of the capacity of plants. But again, to make such zero-sum comparisons already accepts incorrectly that consciousness is a single metric or set complex of matrices, which is invariant and exhaustively discovered. Yeah. Bye, Anne. Thanks for stopping by. Yeah, it's like, streaming is not always the easiest thing. And one of the streamers I watched a lot of, Electric Mermaid, has, you know, stopped being a consistent streamer. They got a job. They couldn't keep it up, I think, enough at the level that they wanted to. And that meant, like, you know, they just couldn't keep the revenue coming in because they didn't think they could... stream what they wanted as they wanted to. So it's like, it's just hard. But like, yeah, and that happens at every level. Like, you have to have stuff to do every time, and then like, is it any good? And who knows? And you have to want to do it. Okay. Physicalist accounts are generally eschewed in biosemiotics, as semiosis itself reflects the Umwelt of the organism, not the Umgebung. Thus, perhaps we could ask, what influence do different environments have on enabling or disabling different forms of consciousness? The interfaces of organisms' sensory apparatuses are constrained and are not veridical with some final reality. There is a reality that can only be asymptotically understood through our Umwelt, and the Umwelt is your, like, lived scenery. Like, it's not your consciousness. It's like the sort of things that your consciousness and your physical senses allow you to see. So, like, you know, somebody like an organism that has a different range of light, they can see different colors, will see a different world than I will. And so it's like, I am limited by, you know, the range of colors that humans can see, or like what I can see, if you like, even if I don't have even that range. So that's Umwelt, what you can see as given to you by the limits of your senses. So you can only, you can understand through your Umwelt, and while technology can extend it, ultimately it is always already constrained by our species-specific sensory capacities. Dashboard representations of the world, rather than offering special insight, constrain our understanding of mindedness of other organisms, especially when their consciousness intelligence is vastly different from ours. And this was, like I was saying earlier, the problem of aliens. Like, how do we actually recognize an alien intelligence which may be extremely different from ours? It's like, how do you, like, get alien messaging? Who knows? Like, Can you actually pick up like alien conversations? Would it even make sense to us? Rather than seeing non-human forms of consciousness as deviating from ours, declining on the same spectrum, what is proposed here is not an extensionist conception of consciousness, but a thoroughgoingly plural, radically plural, from the bottom up form. Okay, so like other things are basically conscious, but we just don't understand their consciousness now. So maybe is this like a full-on, I don't know, like a, what's it called? Jeez, blanking on words. It's like we're a panpsychist view, where everything is conscious, we just don't understand it, so. To be clear, while I find Hofstadter's V-diagram useful for problematizing clear cuts of consciousness such as Jablonka and Ginsburg's, Jablonka and Ginsburg make, I do not endorse it because it still posits consciousness as a more or less attribute according to a single spectrum. If you have that one V where some things have a little bit and other things have a lot, that's a spectrum of consciousness, and the author is rejecting that. This is more like blobs out in space where we have overlapping consciousness. Perhaps the lumping of different types of awareness into one set is part of the main dilemma, which precludes us from valuing and validating forms of consciousness that other beings such as plants may possess, which we do not. If there is a plurality of modes of consciousness, it is possible that we as a species may not possess all the forms or attributes, or at least not have maximal levels of each compared with other alloorganisms. This suggests that there may be a trade-off, that if there are multiple forms of consciousness that interpolate into a single conscious experience for the organism, that perhaps what we gain in some areas, we lose in others. Such notions are now being reintroduced into our own species as study of neurodiversity. Weird people and emotional intelligence complicate single metric or unitary spectrum hierarchical models of consciousness. Yeah, and this is... that's true. We are starting to say, hey, look, there is no like neurotypical human. There may be a larger group of some people, but like to call them neurotypical is to, you know, give them like the default status. And that might not be fair. Maybe that's just, you know, being the biggest group doesn't make it the default. It just means that like that's the biggest group. Nothing wrong with the minority groups in that area too, and in some sense there's a reason why the minority groups stick around, is because they have unique abilities that the larger group does not. And so even though they're the smaller group, that doesn't make them bad, it just makes them unique, and whatever, it's fine. So emergence and souls. The term soul in this target article references the Aristotelian notion of autopoiesis, the self-making dynamics of what some call negentropy, but which transcend merely a physical process. See this person. Jablonka and Ginsburg figure 1, translating Aristotle's four causes into Tinbergen's four causes is illuminating, suggesting that formal and final causes are isometric for living beings, but manifest as phylogeny and function. Yeah, this is one of these things that annoy me. Like, the fact that you can translate Aristotle's four causes into, like, what we talk about today means that Aristotle's metaphysics was good. It's just we have different terms nowadays, but the fact is he didn't fuck up his metaphysics that bad. His metaphysics is halfway decent. That's why people are still, you know, studying Aristotle and his metaphysics. And so it's like, just because we have different terms doesn't mean he didn't have the sort of the categories correct. And so it's like, it shouldn't actually, like, if you are on my side of the world, if you're more of a metaphysician, the fact that like people are just recapitulating like old but good metaphysics is completely unsurprising. Like, it's just how people do it. And like, oh yeah, we've got this great theory. It's like, yeah, you got this great theory. That's because like it's been passed down to you through Western culture since fucking Aristotle. It's like, yeah, that's why you're so clever, okay? It's like, yeah, you figured out what the Greeks knew 2,000 years ago. Okay, and while physics and chemistry do achieve their work according to their own rules, without a stake in the game, so to speak, living beings indeed change the environment in accordance with their own aims, in their own image, intentionally or not. Living beings are not passive forces neutral to the outcome like an earthquake might seem, but rather are goal-oriented in their own changes, consciously consciously or not. I mean, yeah, we change our environment, and that, again, creates a feedback loop. You know, you actually create your own little niche in the world. Like, so it creates a feedback loop, and then you get more and more creating the world, and the world then affects how you exist within it. Okay, so thus we are composed of millions of teleologies, with our self-conscious one just being the cherry on the top of all the rest. Put another way, much of our unconscious desires and action orientations are not ours at all, sensu stricto, but are amalgams of many different organisms. Distancing ourselves from ownership over our experience is perhaps as important a world historic move as it was for us as a species to posit individual self-consciousness. Yeah, so they're trying to pull apart all the things in our consciousness and saying, look, we are kind of like plants in this way, we are kind of like other animals in this way, so the idea that there's any one thing, like our conscious, is like, that might be a very different way of looking at it. Perhaps what we think... Hey, Cinesemiotics. Hey, how you doing? We were actually reading something on biosemiotic agency. How do you, I don't know how long you've been, here, but, like, thank you for the sub, first of all. But, yeah, we were just discussing how things, you know, auto, create themselves as signs. Things like, self-generating, semiotic systems. Hey, and Ivan came. What's up, Ivan? Hope the rest of the stream went well. Let's give Ivan a shout-out. Thank you for the raid. Yeah, it's actually not that bad. None. Oh, I fucked it up. What's the link to this? Let me get the link here. Yeah, how's it? What, Ivan's starting a new religion. Are you a cult leader, Ivan? What are you doing? Let me get the link in chat before I fuck it up. Got to do this. Okay, there we go. Thank you for your patience. Hey, second subscription. Thank you for the, you were the right Reverend Ivan Neo. Well, Reverend Neo, welcome in. I appreciate the sub. Thank you very, very much. Yeah, so anyone who does not know, Ivan chats, science and philosophy over, and technology about there. Oh, he's a technomage. Right Reverend and left Lieutenant? Leftenant. Yeah. Technomage. Okay. So that's good. We're starting religion, maybe you can get up to, like, cult leader, and then, you know, that's kind of, has a lot of, you know, benefits being a cult leader, and that would be, kind of cool. Let me know. Yeah, so, what I do, anyone who doesn't know me, I read and discuss philosophy papers. We were just reading this paper on, biosemiotic agency as emergence. So this is, the consciousness and souls are Aristotelian. What is the driving force in life, and that this author is positing that a self-replicating system of signs, a semiosis, is actually how we can describe life. So it's a semiotic viewpoint on what life is, and where you're a self-replicating system of signs, and how would we actually look at consciousness as a system of signs, something that creates a system of signs and replicates systems of signs. Yeah. Well, you can click on the link and find out. There's a dental plan for cult leaders, I'm pretty sure. Lots of benefits. Exactly. You might get, like, better dental if you're a cult leader. So, yeah. So, this is looking at things more from, you know, this is not the physical generation of life, but looking at it of, like, what does it do? What does life do? And this author is arguing that, look, you have to separate out. You can't just think of, and let me show you the graph up here. You can't just have a spectrum of human consciousness. You can't just assume that goldfish and bees are on the same scale as adult humans. Maybe their consciousness, they are conscious and they're different from us. And so the idea that we can just put, like, a, you know, a graph where it'd be like, we have more consciousness than they do because we're, like, smarter and better, maybe that's wrong. So maybe trees have a different kind of consciousness than bees and humans are over here, but, like, there's overlap. And so there's not, you have to look more at how do they actually interact with their environment, creating and, like, interacting with the way they understand it. And that's, of course, in semiotics, you're talking about how they understand their environment through signs. But, like, maybe there's just overlap between, you know, us and cats, but also overlap between us and trees, but less overlap. But you can't actually say that the trees aren't conscious because We're only looking at our own overlap with it. Yeah. Oh, I haven't had you for detention? Well. Yeah, well, that's why it's roulette. You don't know what you're going to land on. So, So, I mean, it's a very short paper. Like, it's only 6 pages. And that includes this really big graph up here. And, like, it's, and, you know, the references. So, like, if you want to go take a look at it, it won't take very long. It's just this Aristotelian view that once you put it into the semiotic worldview, then it's different. You spent literally the entire time looking for this. Oh, let's take a look real fast. What has Vipers brought for us? Okay. So this is something else. This is a little bit of a video. Okay, yeah, so, I'd have to do a video capture for this. Yeah, it's a twerking bee. Yeah, okay. I'd be a pain in the butt to, show, but, let's finish up the paper, but yeah, we can also maybe watch it. But yes, anyone wants to see a bee dancing. And that's the thing. We know bees can now do math. Bees can do math. So, if we're talking about insects that can do math, then maybe our theory of consciousness needs to be adjusted because it doesn't fit clearly into like a spectrum of stuff. Can they though? I mean, we could go and find that recent paper that claimed they could. I don't know, but that was the thing. It looked like they were doing some simple math. I don't know if they do. They know about irrational numbers. I did not consult the bee experts on that, semiotics. Yeah, so, you know, what's it called? And like, I was very happy about, in mathematical tinkerers, like, squirrels. Squirrels have a theory of mind. They distinguish between squirrel minds and human minds. Squirrels will, if they think they're being watched by another squirrel, squirrels will pretend to hide their nuts up to 5 times. So like, you know, squirrels bury their nuts, they hide their nuts for future use. If they think another squirrel is watching them, they will fake hide their nuts and like try to make it like they hid their nuts and then go hide them someplace else. But if they think squirrels are watching, they don't because they know the squirrels are going to steal them. They do not care if a human is watching them, though. That means they distinguish between squirrel minds and human minds. They know squirrels may steal their nuts. They also know that humans won't. Now, how much do you want to read into that? I don't know. But it does seem to give evidence that they can distinguish between squirrel thoughts and non-squirrel thoughts. Viper says, maybe that's how we recognize alien intelligence. We point our telescopes at their plants, and they're already shaking their booty. I mean, my grandma always used to say that vanity is sanity. So, like, the idea that we're vain actually is a marker of rationality. Yeah. And corvids do the same thing. See, that's cool. So, but, like, does that imply that they have a theory of mind? That they know about other things having minds and that certain things have minds that are important and other ones don't? What's up, Unreal? It really behooves all of us to hide our nuts when the environment is threatening. Yeah, exactly. But you have to know what's threatening. It's like, so, are you threatened by other squirrels or are you threatened by humans? So it's like, that's the thing. All right, so it's literally just his last little bit. Let's finish this up. They have a theory of nuts at least. Exactly. But that is something like value and nuts and like thieving and stuff like that. So it's like, that's getting complicated once you start putting together like that they are aware of being watched and that they have things of value that they could lose and like, it's like all of a sudden that starts getting a little harder to explain in just sort of the behaviorist terms. Okay. Yeah, so this sentence is very, very grandiose, but they're just saying we have to look at consciousness not as a continuum, but as potentially many different sort of different kinds of consciousness, pluralistic consciousness, so that different things can have can be conscious, but it will be very different from our own. Okay, perhaps what we think of as possessing as a possession is instead a gift afforded by particular reflections from our environment. As Whitehead reflected, consciousness flickers, and even at its brightest, there is a small focal region of clear illumination and a large penumbral region of experience which tells of intense experience in dim apprehension. The simplicity of clear consciousness is no measure of the complexity of complete experience. Also, the character of our experience suggests that consciousness is the crown of experience, only occasionally attained and not necessarily its necessary base. Yeah. So exactly, Shaka when the nuts fell. That makes perfect sense. What's it like to be a twerking bee? Exactly. Yeah. These are the questions philosophers ask. Okay. The human emergence and addition of our particular form of conscious experience often is minor compared to the inertia of the other agents which use our superorganism to do their own bidding, or at least try to do so in the mesh of other aims, often conflicting. If we wish to improve human decision-making and extend the flicker of consciousness a little longer, we must focus on retaining complex ecological systems and regenerating degraded ones so that our symbionts flourishing may encourage our own. Yeah, okay. So it's like, this is the thing. How are we gonna, like, say, even if we take one of the things we already think has a lot of mind, say an octopus or some other primates, how are we to actually understand their intelligence if we destroy their environment? If their only best their intelligence really is only super, like, on top of things in, like, you know, their best environment, in, like, under the sea or in, like, some rainforest somewhere, how are we actually to understand their consciousness if we take them out and they're looking at them in, like, you know, a fish tank? The octopus is not actually going to be able to perform at its best. And so this is interesting. They're saying, look, the claim for understanding consciousness, alternate consciousnesses besides human ones, require us to protect the environment of other things that might be conscious. That way we can actually observe some of the more impressive feats of their minds and have better things to study to actually learn about consciousness. If we are only looking at, you know, things in, like, artificial situations like the labs, we're not actually going to be getting consciousness. We're going to be getting some sort of degraded something else. And that's why we don't understand the consciousness, because we're looking at the wrong phenomena. What is human environment NYC? Yeah, that's part of the problem here. That's a good question, Vipers. Who knows what our environment is? Who knows exactly what the best environment for any organism is? Granted, when we destroy it, we can tell that's not a good one. But it's like, it's a little bit, a little begging the question here. Real Brian says life is much better down where it's wetter, under the sea. Yes. But that's the question. If we want to look for conscious phenomena in other species, taking them out of their environments and trying to study them in the lab may not be the way to go about it. And that makes some sense. Like, you're not going to actually see humans doing the most impressive things if you put them in a lab. You have to go out and see what people are actually doing. And, like, that's the sort of thing that, you know, seems to make sense. Like, you don't take people and you put them in, like, prison and then be like, this is what a flourishing human looks like. It's like, no, that's not what a flourishing human looks like. So. And of course, there's arguments that we shouldn't be living in cities this big, like New York City, and that fucks us up. And maybe that is a good point. Yeah, the rat park, exactly. I was thinking of the same thing. If you put too many rats together, it changes their behaviors. Now, the question is that right or good or bad? I don't know. I'm not putting a moral thing on that. But you may not be understanding, like, what the rats are up to, because it is really affecting their dynamics. So, rat park. Because we read a paper on that not too long ago. If you put too many rats in a cage, their behaviors really go differently. Yeah. Okay, so. Okay, so they had morphine in them. Oh, dear Lord. Yeah, so they drank the plain water. Okay, yeah, so this is craziness. They were drugging rats. All right. Yeah, something to read up on. Took the morphine instantly, even with relatively little sweetener. And yeah, so that's a lot of fucking morphine. Meth junkies on subways, yeah. Oh, yep. So yeah, it's gonna mess people up. Yep. that isolated cages as well as female sex caused an increased consumption of morphine. So it's like, yeah, you end up doing different, you act different when you're in these weird or these unusual situations. So all of a sudden you're getting drugged, you start acting really different. Basically, rats on their own chose the morphine. Rats with a lot of companions and toys did not. So again, it's like, yeah, do you turn to drugs when you are having a crappy life? Maybe. But like, if you have a nice life, you got lots of companions and toys, you don't turn to drugs. So, yeah, such a decentering would be based on end and exobiosemiotics. So this is what I was talking about. Like, who knows what an exobiosemiosis is? So like, the system of signs from some other kind of life. Yeah, rather than political, ideological, or economic imperatives as the 20th century struggles between individuals and society were based. Yeah, so it's like, if you're going to look for like signs of life, what sort of symbolic relations are you actually looking for? And it would be a good thing to try to study how organisms like ours, like what we consider to be very intelligent things, change their environment and move around in like their natural habitat. But of course, as soon as we get our big old heads in there, it changes how animals act. So, yeah. You know, this seems like a fun little article. We'd give it a rate. Let's go give it a rating now. Where's my... Yeah, there we go. So, time to rate. So, if you're in chat, you are welcome to rate. You're welcome to rate it right now. What you do is you grab one of these emotes and you do it. If you're just typing it out, you use the stuff all the way on the right, not the title, the one all the way over, and that's what it is. So, did this have fun ideas make your brain dance? Did this have big claims that shrivel up? Was this navel gazing only for academics? Did this talk about deep ancient mysteries, big ideas? Did this talk about existential, what it is to be alive, or have some sort of drama in it? Was this a shiny piece of turd? Was it all style, no substance? There was still poop underneath. And the knife, did this slice and dice, like an analytic thing? I don't think this was a very slice and dicey thing. It brought up a few points, and I thought they were good. You know, what it did do is, I don't know how well you can see it. It says, look, you don't treat consciousness like a spectrum. What we're going to do is treat it like pluralistic consciousness. Evan O'Brien says, Seebach, who was one of the originators of the tradition that Henlin is working on, tried to come up with ways to signal people tons, hundreds, thousands of years in the future to avoid nuclear waste. Yeah, it's not quite xenosemiotics, but heading that way. Exactly. So symbolism that we use to signal danger. How do you tell some people that may not know what danger is for us that something is very, very dangerous? Because, you know, chances are if you're burying nuclear waste, it's dangerous for everybody. So how do you do that? So I'm going to go with brain dance. I'm going to give this a vote yay because I like this little paper. Vote yay. I'm going to give it a brain. And that's a Brian dance. Brain dance. Is there anything else? Like, was this some deep ideas? You know, maybe. We could discuss, like, you know, this did talk about consciousness and, like, sort of mind and other animal minds. Does that give you anything? I'm not so sure. But the idea of a pluralistic view of mind. Yours is not... It did work. It shows up on... Can you see it on screen? Yeah. You thought it was fun, even though you weren't here for all of it? It was fun. Yours did work, I think, semiotics. I mean, can you see it on the video feed? Yeah. I'm also... Should I give it... Let's see. Should I get an existential or an Ouroboros on this? I don't think it gives it an existential. Yeah. So, yeah, sometimes things fuck up. I mean, my, what's it called? It was screwing up. Yeah, it's just not iPhone chat. Yeah, that's what I think. Better TTV is having some problems recently. I was in a chat a few days ago, and I was definitely not seeing certain emotes. So we're going to give it this for now. And I don't know. Maybe I'll give it an Ouroboros if I feel like it. So, yeah, but now, if anyone, like I said, feel free to get your votes in. Let me know how you feel about this. Yeah. So, let's see. Is there anything else to say? Yeah, I mean, the pluralistic consciousness, it's interesting. But again, where are we going to, how are you going to actually do that? Now, they suggested you have to look at, you know, things in their proper environments to understand what they're really super smart about. We have to look at that. But can we actually get out of our own skin? Like, can humans actually get out of our own? So this is what we were talking about in Ivan Neos. Ivan, if something has a consciousness very, very different from ours, you think we can understand it. Full stop. This author is saying no. If maybe that trees are conscious in some way, we do not understand it because we do not have sufficient overlap with the kind of consciousness that trees have. And so the question then is that legit? And what we were talking about in your chat was no. And if you're not here, that's cool too. But it's like, I understand. You, after stream, you got to go take a break, go get some food, do the things. But yeah. So we got Ouroboros out of Aristotle. So yeah, Ivan Neos says, nay. I think just Ivan's angry. He was not judging the paper, just doesn't like its conclusion. But you see, people have different ideas. And that's the point, is that you can argue for this because we don't know what consciousness is, and so maybe there's things we don't know about it yet. Yeah, Ivan angry. No, trees have no abstractions. No abstractions like we have abstractions. Maybe they have other ones. And that's the point. Do you know? You don't know if trees don't have abstractions. You just know that they don't have human-level abstractions. And that's what this author is arguing. Now, I know you don't like these arguments. You're just saying, oh, you're just saying things we don't understand, and that's where, you know, everything gets in, and that's hand-wavy. I got that. But, you know, it's like certain animals, yeah, see, so you got a position, abstraction machines, we have neural nets, yeah, and that's what they do. Trees, they don't operate on our same time scales. But again, this is what you're committed to then, Ivan, is that you've got, you know, things that have neural nets, and then that's really what consciousness is, and then you've got like some sort of, you know, just one big old graph of things that can handle neural nets and things that can't, and then things that, you know, do it less well, like, you know, just normal human adults going down to brain damaged ones, primates, cetaceans, and cephalopods, dogs, chickens, maybe cats, goldfish, bees, trees, fungi, and all the way down to no consciousness here where the trees are little with like plant life. Yeah. So, slow consciousness, maybe. Well, that's the question, Unreal Brian. Like, how would we actually understand a consciousness that was taking a lot longer to move? So trees pine all their lives to be fours. It's got to be a pun there. Yeah. Ivan says, we can imagine worlds where trees have alternate structures that support abstractions, but trees in our world apparently have no such thing. Yeah. I agree that they have no neural nets. We don't know if they have the concept of, like, if there is some sort of abstraction that they could do using biology we just don't understand at the moment. Like, there's a lot of stuff that we just don't understand about how things interact with each other. And, that's possible. It seems unlikely. But again, that's the point here, is that maybe there is something that we haven't been looking at with other species, and maybe we can know. All right, so is about it. I don't think anyone else is getting their... Yeah, Ivan hasn't run into an end. If that's it for the review. You have another few seconds to do it, but like that'll be it for now. Yeah. So Viper says, Ivan, if an alien had a completely different set of senses, not sight or sound, but a completely different set we can't sense, aren't aware of, and can't even infer from what we can sense, could we communicate with those aliens? So yeah. Yeah, so I completely agree, Ivan. Trees can react to stuff, but their networks are not abstract, they're reactive. That's what we understand of trees at the moment. Maybe we just haven't been looking at the right stuff. And that's the question, is maybe if we've always been looking at the sort of conscious stuff we have missed other forms of consciousness that might be out there, especially since we are limited things. And, you know, we are only doing a little bit of consciousness every so often, maybe, or whatever that is. Who knows? All right, so that's it for this. Thank you all for your ratings and the discussion.